Good morning. Today's date is June 4th, 2007. My name is Richard Nicholas. Today I will be conducting an oral history interview with Robert Rosenblatt for the Veterans History Project in partnership with the Dalton Council on Aging. This interview is being held at the Dalton Community Television Studio in Dalton, Massachusetts. Good morning, Bob.
Good morning.
Bob, could you please, for the record, please state your full name and would you spell your last name?
My name is Robert J. Rosenblatt, a.k.a. Bob Rosenblatt, R-O-S-E-N-B-L-A-T-T.
And where do you presently live, Bob?
In Pittsfield.
Massachusetts.
Massachusetts.
And what was your date of birth and where were you born?
26th of March, 1921 in Brooklyn, New York.
Brooklyn, New York. Did you grow up and go to school there?
Yes. From kindergarten all the way through college.
And do you remember what it was like growing up in Brooklyn at this time during the Depression?
Yes. The lifelong image I have of my family, very supported, seemed that the type of home we came for prepared us, seems strange to say this, prepared us for what was to come, the Depression. Were there hardships? Yes, but looking back, I don't think I realized the hardships because weren't all of us in the same situation.
And you mentioned your family unity helped.
I think so. There were my sister. I had an older sister and a younger sister. My dad worked so hard, and of course my mother did.
And what did your dad do for a living, Bob?
My father was a small businessman in the sense that, not a small and high, but he had a business, individual entrepreneur. He was what they called a sheet metal and roofing business. He repaired roofs, put new roofs on, and the old tenements of the East Side.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned that he was an immigrant?
Yes. Yes, that he was.
And when did he come to the U.S., Bob?
My dad, I estimate, about 1908.
And where was he from?
Austria. Actually, no identifiable borders, but on his immigration papers it said Austria, and let's say that was it.
Mm-hmm. And you told me that your mom had the same background.
My mother, yes, my mother had the same background. Mm-hmm. Bertha was her name, and my mom came here about 1908, both to Ellis Island, mm-hmm. the port of entry for so many immigrants.
Interesting. Now, did you graduate from high school?
Yes.
And
yes.
When was that?
1939, yes, let's say 1939 from Samuel J. Tilden High School.
In Brooklyn?
Yes, yes.
And what did you do after you graduated from high school?
Well, education reigned supreme in our household, and I went to Brooklyn College.
And what did you major in there, Bob?
I was a history and economics major.
Now, were you still in high school when the Japanese attacked, or were you still in school when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor?
Yes, when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, yes, I was at college, yes.
And you told me that you vividly remember December 7th.
Oh, yes, yes. I had two supportive interests in my life. One of them was sports, and the other was classical music. And I was listening to the radio broadcasts of the New York Philharmonic, and I was flipping, you know, without the old, this was not the age of the remote control. If you wanted to change stations, you got up, went to the radio, and switched, and I would switch to the channel or a station that had the Giants, football Giants, and I think they were playing the Chicago Bears, a football game. So I switched to the Giant game and back to the music of the New York Philharmonic. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly, during the Philharmonic broadcast, we interrupt this broadcast, and that's how we learn of Pearl Harbor. A strange thing about that, I think I was the only one in all my friends who knew where Pearl Harbor And why? Because I was a stamp collector.
I see.
And it was the stamps that helped me it gave me a view of the world other than Brooklyn, New York.
Very interesting. Did you remain in school after Pearl Harbor?
Well, after Pearl Harbor, we were registered. Of course, we were already registered for the draft. There was a draft in that era, and as the need arose and the preparations for war became heavily, I was drafted out of Brooklyn College.
And when was that, Bob? Do you remember?
Well, I would say it had to be in 1942 when I was called up. And yes, 1942.
Okay.
If memory serves me correctly, I think it was June of 42.
And what were your dates of service?
I served from June of 42 to it had to be December. I was in 3 years, 9 months. How about that for math? 3 years, 9 months. And I got home in December, if we do the math. February of 40, let's see, let's do the math. February of 46.
And where did you go for basic training?
Fort Dix, New Jersey.
And do you remember the dates?
Well, not precisely. If I was drafted in June, we went down to Fort Dix, and I was there very briefly. Let me do quick math. About 3 months?
Mm-hmm.
June, July, August of that same year, and I was shipped over to Oklahoma.
But you mentioned that while in basic, you had an interesting assignment.
Well, yes. I was a percussionist in high school, that is a drummer, Tilden High School in Brooklyn College. So the Army leaves no stone unturned, and I became part of the drum corps. And I always kid, half seriously, that our drummers were the ones who woke up the bugler every morning.
And was it hard for you to adjust to this new life, military life?
You know, Dick, that's a good question. I don't think so. I think that my family discipline. Also, there were hard times. The Depression were hard times. There was no things. Life was serious, I believe. And yes, I was a disciplined kid.
Mm-hmm. And after basic training, where did you go?
Well, after basic training, you're referring to Fort Dix.
Yes, after Fort Dix.
Yeah, at Dix, they sent us to Muskogee, Oklahoma. And I joined the 88th Infantry Division, stayed there, did additional training there.
And can you describe some of that training?
Close order drill, as I was introduced, and marching up and down. How to use that time we had the old Springfield rifle. Learned how to use a rifle. Here I was, a kid who didn't even know what a rifle was. I did know which end the bullet came out of, but I tell you, it was a new experience. Doing all the running. I know we did a heck of a lot of running and walking, being prepared for the life of an infantryman.
Mm-hmm. And at Muskogee, you received another assignment, is that correct?
Well, the word came out that they would need officers. And modest, I learned that I was a high IQ kid. This was before the era where IQ made a difference, I think. And they more or less asked for volunteers. And then we were quote unquote ordered to sign up for officer training. Mm-hmm. And I did sign up.
And how long was that training, Beth?
Well, the training, we were shipped out. We were sent to Fort Benning, Georgia, the home, the mecca of the 90-day wonder,
mm-hmm,
of infantry officers. And I was trained there for 90, it had to be 90 days.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, my records had 13 weeks.
And this was to be your training to become a platoon leader?
To become an officer, yes, a second lieutenant, to become a infantry platoon leader.
Now, at Fort Benning, you mentioned that you had occasion to talk to the FBI.
Well, we were lined up for some papers for more interviewed, and then they called out, never referred to us by first name, Rosenblatt. And you wondered why a man and men, two men in civilian clothing, came over to me and shirt and tie, and it was a bit frightening. What was a civilian doing here? And they brought me into another tent, interviewed me, wanted me to verify that my mother and dad. In fact, they asked me where my mother came from and my father. And 99, many years later, I realized that they knew the answer, where my mother and dad just wanted to hear it from me.
And because of their Austrian background?
Yeah, I think as a scared kid at the time, I realized that my mother and dad came from enemy territory.
Right.
And wanted to see me, wanted to hear what I had to say, and then they released me and I went back to my duties.
Mm-hmm. And when did you receive your commission?
Well, I received my commission when I went in, it was 90 days later. Was it December, I think? Let me do the math. March.
Of 43?
Of 43.
Mm-hmm. And you were commissioned a second lieutenant?
I was commissioned a second lieutenant.
What was your next duty station after Fort Benning?
At Fort Benning, they sent me out to Camp Robinson, California. Yes, and that was my first experience being traveled as an officer. We couldn't travel Pullman. I had a small room. Now, a kid who came from a poor family, so to speak, living in traveling across country in this railroad car, in a Pullman car, it was impressive. I had this room to myself, my own little, if you can call it that, commode in privacy.
And you mentioned you had a fried chicken experience?
Well, I learned that people had to eat. And I went into a diner. I had these chits that the government picked up, and I walked in. It was empty. And I sat down at this table. There was another man, and they happened to be an officer. I did not know the rank. Here I was, as we refer to as a shaved tail, and this gruff voice said to me, "Hey, Lieutenant, I'm alone. Sit down with me." And he ordered me to do so, and I sat with him. And I offered, I still know what I ordered, Southern fried chicken. And what's the best way to eat Southern fried chicken? If you picked it up with a hand. Well, if you're supposed to eat it with your hand, you just don't do that in front of a chicken kernel, that is, a full kernel. And I started to eat the chicken, and I picked with it at a fork, and the next thing I heard a strong voice boom out, "Lieutenant, you don't eat the damn chicken like that. Pick the goddamn thing up and eat it with your hands." And I did.
Following orders.
Following orders.
Now, you received, you said, administrative training at...
At Camp Roberts?
Yes.
At Camp Roberts, yes. And I wondered why. Why am I not being trained to do what a second lieutenant is supposed to do in infantry? And I was doing lots of administrative training, keeping the books of the battalion post exchange, where a person so poor in math had to keep the books. Yes.
Now, after about 4 weeks of this training, you received the furlough?
I received the furlough, but that furlough was kicked in, was related to, I was sent for other duty to back to Fort Benning, Georgia. So on the way home, the Army used good judgment and gave me 10-day leave.
And you mentioned You had some feelings when you got home.
Yes, seeing my parents and my sisters after so many, well, it seemed that eternally that I hadn't seen them. And I noticed how my father, more than my mother, had aged. And that was a lesson in life, that people do age. We don't stay the same eternally.
Right.
And there's my dad, he looked older, but he looked good. He looked good. And so did my mom. And of course, what do parents do, especially a mom, do for their only son who comes home, would never be away from home, gave me all the food that I loved.
That's great. Now, you mentioned you went back to Fort Benning.
Yes.
What type of training did you receive now?
The infantry divisions are different than the way they are today. The infantry divisions had cannon companies under the direct command of the colonel who controlled the regiment. So I was trained how to be a forward observer for a cannon company.
Mm-hmm. And of course your MOS changed at this time?
Yes, yes. Instead of becoming an infantry platoon leader, I became an infantry cannon company officer.
I see.
You still wore the cross rifles that infantry officers carried.
Pardon me. Now, after your training here at Benning, where did you go?
Well, I was lucky. I came north to Brooklyn, New York for a brief leave. They put me on a car and I joined the 79th Infantry Division. I believe, yes, they were in Arizona.
You mentioned Camp Phillips.
You know, there's Dick, I think there's a little confusion. I went to Arizona for desert training,
mm-hmm.
and I joined up with the division at that particular time.
Okay.
You know, for desert training, and in reflection, desert implies heat, and you bet it was hot. We were learning with infantrymen how to coordinate attacks with tanks. And after our day's activities, there was night work, the men would come back to their tents thirsty. And the first thing they ran was the post exchange for cold Coke. Right? Wrong. And what was wrong about it, the medics were furious because men started to have severe stomach cramps.
Mm-hmm.
And the next thing we knew, no more cold Coke. That would be a good commercial for the Coca-Cola company.
So you were probably under the impression that you were going to go to Africa at this time?
Yes. The Army in its own way had, it was disinformation, actually. Yes. What else is one to think?
Right. And then you mentioned that you went to Camp Miles Standish?
Well, we went to Camp Phillips for further training.
Mm-hmm.
When we went to, the weather there, as I recall, was much colder, and we went for further training, and then we received our orders.
Okay. And when you shipped out of Boston from Miles Standish?
Yes, Miles Standish. What a coincidence that is, where Massachusetts in the future became my home, and we shipped out of the Boston port of embarkation.
And do you remember the date?
December? Let me think. April. April, it had to be April 44.
Mm-hmm. April. And you were bound for England?
Bound for England.
And can you describe the ship you were on?
It was a converted passenger ship. And fed it for the troops, and I remember the troops. What else are the troops going to be doing? I think the trip took about 9 days.
Mm-hmm.
Played cards and cards. I don't probably read a lot on the crossing. I think it was a smooth crossing,
mm-hmm.
Fortunately. And we landed in Manchester, England. It was dark.
Now, what was your training in Manchester? What type of training did you receive
Well, we
there?
Moved from Manchester. They trucked us to another area along the coasts and near the invasion, English invasion coasts. And the men, from that time on, we traveled training through the English countryside. You must remember, geographically, England is a small nation. There isn't this maneuver area. If you had to do, you had to wait in line, actually, for the to have artillery fire, mm-hmm. to learn how to fire these guns in coordination with the infantry troops. A lot of waiting, and waiting. Weather, rain, and rain.
And you told me you had a pleasant experience with some English people.
Yes, they sponsored. We received time off, and I remember going to a local place for recreation. And I couldn't use the word rest. Rest from what? But we went for recreation, and there, this was the first time in my life, the only time, I think, that I met nobility. And I subsequently learned that one of the women who was hosting us, her husband was a commanding general of the British forces in Africa. And they were serving tea and small crumpets. Now, I was accustomed to drink tea out of a glass. And our immigrant home, as my father did, and what they served it in was a cup and a small cup on a saucer. Well, how am I supposed to drink the tea? you fool, I said to myself, they have the tea handle. They were the cup handle. I remember doing that now. Do I stick my finger out and do that? And that's all in retrospect,
right.
At the time. But did I enjoy the tea? No, because I was too nervous.
Right. Did you eventually sail for France?
Yes. We would sail on this time it was not luxury. They piled us into a larger landing craft. All the troops came on this wonderful craft, headed for the beaches. Mm-hmm. The invasion had already begun, and we were aboard that. And I remember we were also very nervous. Weather was not good. The weather was not good, and there the concern was how it would be when we went to the beaches.
Mm-hmm. And do you remember the date that you did land?
Well, let me do them. Let's see, June 14.
So that was about a week after.
Yes. That. Yes.
Now, where did you land?
We landed in Utah Beach, and as a distraction, Dick, I'd like to share this with you. That if you ever thought of this great United States as being a country that knows how to produce things, it seemed to me there were 4,000 ships in the channel. It would the thunderous noise from the battleships. Our ship was not too far from a huge battleship that was belching fire and smoke at these 16-inch. Wouldn't you say they were 16-inch guns? And these shells went over our head. It sounded like a 2,000-pound car going over our head, one after another. The destroyers firing close in. The ships actually clouded the planes, clouded the sky. And what did you have? Smoke, noise, and thunder in the sky. Sounds dramatic, because it was dramatic.
And then you stepped foot on shore and you
We stepped in on shore. And the anxiety, you've got to realize the anxiety was lessened, because we thought in our own image there would be resistance. Now, this is before history would give us the image of what happened. Mm-hmm. And we landed on, and we know we landed running. And why did we run? Because the MPs wanted to clear the beaches quickly, because men and material were coming in at the same time. The beaches had to be cleared quickly to get all this running for the troops up here. And that was the first time that I heard enemy fire. The guns up in the front where we were headed for.
And did you know what your objective was at this time?
Distantly, yes. At the particular time, the generals knew where we were going. And ultimately, we learned for the port of Cherbourg, it was very important for the American forces to seize a big city, a big port city, Cherbourg.
And how soon after your arrival were you personally engaged in combat?
It seemed like the blink of an eye. You know, I can't account for time. I know that somehow I was in a Jeep. And in that Jeep was my Jeep driver. Zygmunt was his name, from North Carolina. And my radio operator came from Pottstown, Pennsylvania. My gracious, I remembered that. And we headed to catch up with the company to which we were assigned. Mm-hmm. Going towards Cherbourg, trying to catch up. And would you believe it? I must admit this, that we got lost. And that was an eerie sensation, getting lost and our first time headed to combat. And I suddenly realized that we were on a road we should not be on, because we were going away from the noise of warfare, and it was very quiet. And I think it was my Jeep driver who said, "Lieutenant, we better get the H out of here." And as he said that, I saw my first destruction, a real destruction of, well, death. Why? Because there were enemy soldiers, German soldiers. And how strange life is that I often wondered how I would have felt if it was American dead that I had seen. It's cruel to say that, but you had to learn fast.
And this is about the same time that you became a casualty yourself, is that right?
Yes. We were on a road, and there were tanks moving in another direction than we were. And my Jeep driver had to move to the side, and as he did, there was an explosion. Our tank, our Jeep ran over a mine, and next thing I knew, that the sound was turned off. It's something like losing sound on your radio or your TV set, and I saw people move their lips, and this explosion had deafened me. My Jeep driver and my radio operator fortunately weren't injured, and I had lost my hearing, but it came back. But I had a perforated eardrum was the result of it. I lost.
And for this, you received your first Purple Heart.
My first Purple Heart, yes.
And you also had another distinction as a result of this, right? First one in your company?
Yes, Dick, as you say, distinction. our men would worry about casualties. I guess that's always on you. And I had the distinction of being the first person of being wounded. And yes, I was the first.
Now, I got a little ahead of myself. And can you describe your unit and what your duties were as a forward observer?
As we said early on, this was a cannon company. That cannon company would give very close, it's different. How do you best describe it? There was artillery assigned to every division, but that artillery was not under the command of our regimental commander. Our cannon company, as I said early on, was under the direct control of our regimental commander, and if we were assigned to a battalion or a company, they would be the battalion commander, who was a colonel. He would have control over us. I, as an officer, was assigned to an infantry company. Early on, my assignment was I Company, an infantry company. Ryan, at that time, he was a lieutenant. He subsequently became a captain, red-headed guy. And Ryan was the guy who I became a friend. We became friends as a result. And
And what type of weapons were in this cannon?
105 howitzers.
Now, can you describe your action after the capture of Cherbourg?
Well, the Army lost no time. Our objective was to move on and, harsh as it sound, to get the Germans to run and kill as many as you could. Sounds like George Patton, but that's the realities of warfare.
And can you tell me the name of the peninsula that you were moving along?
The Cotan. It's a good challenge. Cotten. Well, let's leave it at that. I better not spell. The Cotan Peninsula. That would be moving towards out of France. But yes.
And there were German counterattacks at this time?
Frequently. The Germans were a ferocious enemy. There was no time for rest. You moved, and moved. Take ground. And you kept on moving forward. Fortunately, it wasn't walking all the time. There were trucks, tractors ahead. We seemed to be leapfrogging. And we had the Germans on the run.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned air cover was heavy at this time.
Yes, always, frequently. At that time of the warfare, fortunately, we had the air cover. And you saw the planes zooming over us all the time. You heard their guns fire. And you know, that kind of fire was good fire, yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, after the fighting on this peninsula, can you describe the action where you received your second Purple Heart?
Vividly. This is a contrast in life. What nature could do for life, it was so green. We'd come out of the hedgerows, and we were atop. Infantry phrase is, see the high ground, and we had high ground. And I remember we were dug in. First thing you came to a hill, dig in. The sand was soft and we had dug in. And I was overlooking this gully, not a gully, a valley, more like a valley. And we could distinctly see the Germans down below and they weren't about to give up. I saw several trucks, I saw infantry troops. And to the left, suddenly to our left, a couple of tanks. Tanks pulled up. You know, it seems strange. Your training never leaves you. And I wondered, why are these tanks on top rather than just backing off the hill so they shouldn't be entirely, the whole tank should not be seen as a target.
Mm-hmm.
And there they were.
And were, it seems not to interrupt you, but were you directing fire in
then I
the
began,
Germans?
I began directing artillery fire, my cannon fire. And I remember the first three, four rounds going over, bypassing where the trucks and the enemy was. And the Germans were as smart as we were. They knew where that fire was coming from. And suddenly there was a distraction. One of the American tanks was hit. And there's where I saw my first real horror of warfare. When a tank was hit by a shell, I might add that the Germans' most destructive weapon, at least for an infantryman, was the 88. And it hit, and there was an explosion from the tank, and I remember the men jumping out of the tank. I don't know what it was, a three-man crew, and one of them had the fire on his clothing was burning, and you could smell the burning of flesh. But then I was distracted again by where we were, and explosions all around us. The enemy had honed in on us, and they wanted to get rid of the observers, a forward observer like myself. So they didn't take fire from us. And next thing I know is that I kept ordering the fire where I could no longer do that because we were hitting ourselves. And I recall liquid coming out of the right side of my head, and the terror set in. Someone shouted, "Medic!" And to their credit, I just don't know, they came out of the earth like a plant. And I remember the medic taking some kind of cloth and brushing the liquid, which was blood, from my right side of my head. And he reassured me that my head was in shape, but I had other wounds. My right side of my body, primarily my right knee. And they helped me out of where I was, put me on a stretcher. And I remember asking from my radio operator, and he was badly wounded, and we were in effect put out of commission because his radio was gone. And I recall they gave me a shot of morphine for the pain. I don't remember being placed on a stretcher, but I was, because the next incident reminded me that I was indeed on a stretcher. We came off, they took us back off the hill, and we were walking along, being evacuated along the side of a hedgerow. Mind you, it was too dangerous for ambulances to come for it because the fire was still intense. And we could no longer be seen by the enemy because we were on the other side of the hill. Suddenly we heard machine gun fire, and you could hear the bullets. They make a peculiar sound. The medics had no other act but to drop us, and they indeed did. They dropped us to the ground, and they got down to avoid the enemy fire. It seemed within minutes, like the blink of an eye, with that fire stopped. Obviously, they had eliminated the Germans left, and we were taken to an evacuation hospital.
Now, this was in early July of 44, is that
correct?
Yes,
I'll never forget that date. I was wounded July 11th, 1944.
Now, as a result of this action, Bob, you received your award of an Oak Leaf Cluster for your Purple Heart.
Yes.
And you also received the Bronze Star Medal for Heroism, is that
yes,
right?
Yes.
Now, the citation reads that even though you were wounded, you refused to be evacuated, and you continued to direct fire.
Yes. You know, it is a reaction. You have a duty to do, but you don't think of it. It just comes naturally. There's where training comes in. There's where the training, you just stay there, do your work, and yes.
Now, do you know where you were taken for treatment for your wounds?
Well, this evacuation hospital where you were immediately taken care of. Amputations were done there, and you saw a lot of those. You know, it comes to mind the difference of the Civil War soldier, the many amputations that were done there under less than cleared circumstance, and antiseptic circumstance, to what was done here.
Mm-hmm. Now, you received surgery here, is that correct?
Yes, at this, what they had to do is, they did some quick x-rays to find out if indeed the shelf, the fragments of the artillery fire had penetrated my head. But an x-ray found that there was nothing in there. I mean that two ways. They left the fragment of shell, but I did have fragments in my right knee, which they removed, the surgeons removed. I was taken back to a bed, and I came out of whatever they use to make sure you don't feel pain. One or two days later, my index finger, my right hand, started to swell and turn ugly red. And I showed this to the nurse, and she said, "Oops, you have something in there." And I was taken back to the operating room. And if you've ever have seen MASH, this was a typical MASH. I think it was MASH units were invented, the term, during the Korean War, from the famous MASH TV program. And there's where I think I had my first, even before the days of MASH on TV, incident, Whereas Taker, the sergeant looked at it, he was a Southerner, and I was in a Southern division, and he looked at my index finger and he said, well, we could take care of that, injected me with something, became numb, and he cut into it, you feel the pressure. Did I look? I think I did. And he cut into the finger and he tried, he probed a little bit, and I remember him saying, pardon the language, Dick, and he said, come on, you little bastard. He was referring to the sliver, and he finally lifted it and showed it as if an artist had just made a Rembrandt, a beautiful picture. He was so proud, and he said, aha, I got it. And he dramatically picked up, now why do I remember this? He dramatically picked this up, and he had a metal dish, and he's as if to say to me, Lieutenant, you listen. Ping, and what a pleasant ping it was into that cup. Or whatever it was.
Now, you still have the shrapnel piece in your forehead, right?
Yes, yes. You want to feel?
Not right now, but I will. During your stay at this field hospital, you mentioned off camera that you were visited by some dignitaries.
Yes. I think it was good for morale. Secretary of War Stimson. Now, I knew the name. After all, being a history major, you know your governmental leaders. He visited us. Now picture this, soldier, I wasn't the only one there, there were really some men in the side. May I tell you this?
Certainly.
Right beside me there was a soldier, my age, 22, 23, who had lost one of his legs below the knee, I think. And I remember him keep saying to me that, they told me I lost my leg. I don't remember that. I don't remember them taking my leg. It feels, I could feel my toes. If you read any literature or any books or see any movies of today, the soldiers do indeed tell you that. But I wasn't seeing this in a movie. I was having a soldier soldier to my left with head wounds, reminiscent to what we read about in the Iraq War. The next thing I pictured was, here was the Secretary of War. We had been alerted ahead of time. Our beds were made, we were propped up. He came there with brass. As a picture we need to know, he picked up, or his aide did, our record of wounds, and he said, oh, it says here where you were wounded, and he told me you were wounded there, such and such. Ah, Brooklyn, New York, Secretary of War. I don't know if he or another person. Brooklyn, New York. Now, you've got to remember this. A British actor, well-known, I'm sorry I don't know his name, had talked about soldiers from Brooklyn being less than worthy of fighting in wars. Now, I don't know why he said that, but it roused up the world and it made headlines. Even then, especially then, it made news. I was quite sensitive to how the world would look at Brooklyn soldiers, and I was one of them. And here was the three-star generals, maybe even a four-star general. One of them spouted out to me, I see you're from Brooklyn, and I, in my sensitivity, interpret that as being sarcastic, as if to say, ha-ha, you're from Brooklyn, you're from one of those. Did he mean that? Maybe. But then he asked me something that made me laugh internally. Did you know Jack Smith from Brooklyn? Well, if you look in the Brooklyn, in the Brooklyn telephone book, remember, Smith was like asking about Cohen in Tel Aviv and Israel today.
After your release from the field hospital, where did you go about?
We went to, they evacuated us aboard a British hospital ship. Before we go on, I must tell you how the Medical Corps, this is now 60-some years old after the incident, I can't say enough positively is how we were treated as wounded people. I don't think any part of my family could treat us more royally.
Than the British did?
Yes. Not only the American nurses, the American doctors, they interjected humor. We were human beings. Now, compare my wounds were nowhere near the wounds I talked about. Young man, 23, losing a leg. A man sitting to the soldier next to me, the boys next to me, head wounds and worse.
Yeah.
Now, on board the hospital ship, I always knew that the British had a love for lamb. But lamb for breakfast, lamb for lunch, lamb for dinner. And what do you think our last meal aboard ship was, Dave? Lamb.
Lamb.
Now, and suddenly the cry, the music. Now, I had a musical ear, loving classical music. But if some composer could interject this, about lamb, you would hear, bah, bah. That became the carryall, the code word for our soldiers.
Right.
Imitation of lamb.
Imitation called. Of lamb.
Yes. You could write a poem, Imitation of Lamb.
Did the hospital ship return you to England?
Yes, took us back.
And where, Bob?
Oh, there was a center called Birmingham. In England, it was in a beautiful valley where they had seen miles of tents for where soldiers were brought for rest, recuperation, and mostly rehab. I had to learn how to walk with these knee wounds. I remember using crutches.
And your wounds were coming along.
Yes,
well.
The wounds were coming along.
Now, you received some. Surprise visitors, didn't you,
yes.
While you were at Birmingham?
Well, actually, my fiancée, Rosalind, her name is Rosalind Rappan, and her brothers were here. I knew they were in the hospital service. They were, yes. And her younger brother, I didn't even know his first name because we always called him Red. I'm kidding. His name was Herman. He's still alive. And Henry, the older of her two brothers. Henry was a staff sergeant with a hospital corps. Red was an x-ray technician. Coincidence, when I went for my pre-entry exam to the service, would you believe it? He was the x-ray technician.
When you first went in?
Yes. I barely knew him, you know. And he, when I first went in, he was the x-ray technician. My, what you remember.
Right.
Well, Roz had told me that the guys were there, and they learned where I was, and they visited me. So we had a family reunion.
Wow, that's great. And how long were you at Birmingham?
Well, from that time, from July, end of July, after Thanksgiving. I can't recall if we had Thanksgiving there or did I rejoin my... I think I rejoined my company.
Around Thanksgiving?
Yes,
time.
Yes.
You were fit now to return to,
yes,
to duty?
Yes, yes.
Where did you catch up with your company?
The company was we were pretty well out of France. We were now in Germany. Yeah, we were out of Germany, and we were coming close to, no, yeah, we were coming, we had have been in Alsace-Lorraine, and we were, let me think about that. We were in Alsace-Lorraine. Mm-hmm. The city was near Strasbourg.
Okay. Now, what were your feelings when you first got back to your company? How were you received?
I had anxiety. But I was a conquering hero. I'm an ego on an ego trip, but that's what smoothed me back into combat again. Seeing the guys, we had replacements, and being reintroduced to the replacements. Mm-hmm. Remember, being in a cannon company, my cannon company did not receive the heavy casualties that a line company did. The turnover was so rapid there. And no. that helped being treated so royally.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned when we talked earlier that you felt some guilt because of the combat they had been in.
You feel that guilt because this is, One must remember that infantry people, infantry troops, build up a spirit where they of closeness. Death and destruction does that. And you miss these guys. You don't want to leave them. Guilt, yes, having been away. Mm-hmm. But the mere fact treating me as they did, welcome home. It's like parents put up the big signs, but there were no signs to their loved ones who've been to war. You've seen them. Mm-hmm. Welcome home outside your home and the flags. Well, they didn't have the flags.
But there was a
But they had the warmth, that warmth, yes. My mother couldn't have done a better job to arrange that, and neither would my father.
Mm-hmm. Now, where was your regiment in December of 44 when the Germans made their big counteroffensive with the Battle of the Bulge?
Let me give you this picture. We were in the Vosges Mountains covering a tight sector. The Battle of Bulge, Patton's troops were immediately ordered to go to that direction. What does that mean? Obviously, the generals knew that the Germans would not be attacking in force here.
In the mountains.
Yes. They would be attacking elsewhere, going in the Bulge, what became later on. We had no idea that this was the Bulge that was to become. We had no ideas of McCullough's famous nuts of history. We had no idea the casualties we were taking there. What we knew, what was in front of us. The generals don't telephone us and say, "Hey, Rosenblatt, this is what's happening."
Right.
This is what was happening. We knew that our zone that we covered became widened. Instead of our zone were half a mile, it became 5 miles. We were spread out, but so were the Germans. Mm-hmm. We learned later on. We were dug in. We were at the top of this hill. And this prepared me for living in Massachusetts in winter. Snow, you've lived here all your life. Snow. And maybe that's why I have bad teeth today, because your teeth chatted. It was so cold.
And you seriously were concerned with frostbite
My concern was trench foot. Not for myself so much as the troops. Well, yes, myself. I shouldn't be so humble. To make sure you had to remind your medics, went around the troops, made sure that they had warm socks. You change it, keep changing, because at night you were always in snow, and snow, and the medics actually stayed there, watch the guys take the boots off.
To make sure
they change. We were fortunate that each GI had an extra pair of socks. And where do you think they kept it? In the helmet liner. Keep them warm, so they change it. And what did they do with the warm socks? You threw them out.
Now, even though you weren't actively involved in the, you did exchange artillery fire.
Yes, I coined this phrase after the war, whenever. It was a gentlemanly kind, seriously like. The Germans liked to let us know they were still there and lob some shells, and you would lob them back. "Okay, fellas, we're here, we haven't gone away." And that was the exchange at night, yes.
Now, you told me off camera that around this time you received some packages from home. Is that correct?
Well, you might remember this. I said the medics were my heroes. Somehow, you have to give credit to quartermaster in getting us our mail. During combat, mail was sporadic. You just didn't receive it. But then the mail caught up with us. My mom was notorious for packages, and my mother was a writer. I love to write, too. Maybe that's where I get it. Was my mother a better writer? Yes, she was more poignant and from the heart. The postcards piled up, maybe three or four and five. Picture a postcard, 3.5 inches, was it 3.5 inches by four? How does one, my mother mastered that art of getting 62 words to a postcard, all in one sentence. I would murmur under my breath when it became smudged. They were gems.
I bet.
The verb, she never used adjectives. If I should have thought of that when I come home, but they're all in one, and she told us what was happening at home. Papa's doing this, Clara, my older sister, and Dottie, what they were doing. And Roz, she didn't call her Roz, she called her Razel, her Hebrew name, mm-hmm. came for dinner. She came every Friday night. And Roz, to her credit, even today, learned how great my parents were.
That's nice.
And she would have the Sabbath, the Jews' yes. Sabbath was, I came from an Orthodox home. She would come Friday nights, and she told me about a visit and anything that mattered. But those packages. Remember, I don't know if I mentioned that the bulk of the men in my company, my regiment, were Southerners, mainly from Virginia, North Carolina, Virginia and North Carolina, and I introduced them to pickled herring. Now, if you wonder, how do you ship pink pickled herring over 3,000 miles without the glass jar shattering? No, it was never in a glass jar. Because my father made a packet made up of metal, and they would put the pickled herring, maybe the jar, and well insulated, and we got it.
Well, he was in the sheet metal business.
Yes,
right?
He made these little packages. I should have kept them. Plus strudel. Well, all the guys knew what strudel was. And there was a run on strudel. I became the most popular person in the company. Plus salamis from the company called Isaac Gellis from the Lower East Side of Manhattan. Well, I got those packages. Did I save them? Well, we always ran out of food.
And mail from home became more regular now?
Yes, at this time because we were in a static position.
Now, after this, your time in the Vosges Mountains, where did your regiment go?
Well, then we became less static. We learned that whatever was happening up north was over. We didn't know what it was or why that what happened. We didn't know how tragic that situation was and how close the Germans came to breakthroughs. We learned that later. They moved us out to move forward, to chase Germans, to move them in the German. And, there was the first time as we got into Germany, where we saw the enemy civilian and how bombed out what they were going through. But I couldn't get myself to sympathize. I remember driving through the city of Mannheim and how forlorn the enemy was, the civilians, and how they were living. But remember, I was a person coming from London. I had seen London and what the Germans had done to London. Was this reciprocation? Yes. Yes, the enemy, I learned back then that the enemy is very much part of the civilian is very much part of warfare.
Mm-hmm. Now you mentioned that you crossed the Rhine in March of 45?
March was, I think we crossed the Rhine 2 days before my birthday, which was March 24th. We were into 1945.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Now also at this time, you told me that you received some entertainment, USO entertainment?
Yes. The context I don't know, but aside from being a soldier, I was all that time the regimental athletic officer. I was now a first lieutenant. I hadn't gotten my captaincy yet. I was a first lieutenant and was the athletic officer. And in my mind, even what kept me busy besides warfare was planning to organize softball leagues. Our generation, it wasn't only Major League Baseball, it was Major League fast pitch softball. I digress. I received an order that for me to fill up several 2.5-ton trucks, remember, Comeback was pretty much quiet at this time. There was a well-known pianist. I wish I had known who the pianist was, going to give a concert. And how many people in my regiment cared about classical music? I don't know, but we had to fill a truck. Reluctantly filled it. These guys didn't want to go, and I was successful. I got my quota. They took us into a. They took us. Was it back to Strasbourg? I don't know. I really don't know. And we have filled this great concert. I do know this pianist was playing some music by Debussy. What he played, I don't know. But I know that I enjoyed the concert.
And there was a major league baseball player group too, right, that came through?
Well, I was also told that we were going to have a major league baseball player. He played for the Boston Braves. Do you remember the Boston Braves? He played, and he was Freddie Frankhouse. I remember as a kid that he had a curveball that would make any woman who wanted curves to look good, look good, Freddie Frankhouse. And my orders were to take care of him. Now, it's Freddie Frankhouse, I didn't know. I only knew him as a kid. A baseball player, a major league baseball player. I was going to take care of a major league baseball player. When I met him at his Jeep, we helped him out, and I was wondering why he was staggering. And then I smelt his breath, and I knew why. He loved to drink. Uh-huh. He loved to drink.
Now, there was a famous singer, too, that came, right?
Ella Fitzgerald. A tisket, a tasket. May I sing?
Well.
A tisket and a tasket, she, of her fame. And my gracious, she just puts a spirit into the soldiers. I remember the city.
That must have been a great
And it was
relief.
Cold. And it was cold, you know, and she entertained us. I'll never forgive her. I'll never forget her. I'll never forget her.
And you were in this area when you learned of the death of the president?
At that time, we were in German territory. We had moved into the coal mining area. Mm-hmm. And it was just outside of Essen. And we were bivouacked. Now, this time we were inside. It was April. It was still cool, but we appreciated being in the warm atmosphere of this administration building with these huge shower facilities that the miners used also, and the men loved it because they got these hot showers. Mm-hmm. And I recall these huge bathtubs. You want to try the type you want to take home with you. Yes.
And what was the feeling in the regiment when they learned of the president's death?
Have you ever been around troops who love to talk? Conversation was endless among the men when they were outside of battle. Well, it would seem as if the sound was turned off. It cast a pall. These men knew only one president, and Franklin Roosevelt. Most of those troops came from poor families, farming, hardscrabble people who knew only hard work. And their hero died, the man who took them, who probably brought back, who ended the Depression. Their hero had died. We didn't know what had caused the death, but we knew he was dying. It's like looking at an internal flame that was crushed.
Mm. Now, were you in the same area? When
mind if I take up some
certainly
water?
Certainly not. Go ahead. Were you still around Essen when the war ended?
Yes, our war, all intents and purposes, ended in April, end of April, early May is when it ended. Mm-hmm. Oh, no, end of April, yes, early May. And we were just we were on guard duty. And I remember our company commander had gone, so I had become company commander. and received orders. Oh, I've got to tell you this. We received orders and we had moved out. And we were going to, out of tents, the men were already living in some bivouacked area in regular buildings. And I had been in the field a while and I was ordered back to assume my company commandership. I had no idea this bivouac, this area at all. I didn't know where the kitchen was. I didn't know where the latrines were or how they were. And what do you know? I received information from a staff sergeant at headquarters who I knew. Now, you know, we weren't supposed to do this, but I guess he had pity that I did not know that I was new to being a company commander. And he said, the general, the division general is coming to inspect your area. I was frightened. I didn't know where it was. I had to do nothing, as I just told you. Now, when the commanding general comes, you were waiting for him. You wait with your staff outside where your quarters were, because up the jeep. The jeep were rolled in, and I ran, and immediately I saluted him. Lieutenant Rosenblatt, reporting, sir. And he hopped out of the tent, didn't even look at me, and he said, I want to see where your kitchen was. And I didn't know where the hell the kitchen was. And he said, before you do that, I want to see your toilets. I led him to the toilets, I thought, and it was dark. Dark, as if you turned all the lights off. And I finally walked into this place. And he said, turn a goddamn light on. And I don't know, someone did. And we were all in a closet. Can you imagine, picture this? The general, two-star general, and his aides, and all this brass. And he didn't say a word, he just rushed by me. I should have known where the toilets were, you could smell them. Well, that was my experience. I thought I was finished. But somehow I got my captaincy later on.
Now, you mentioned a story about some slave laborers being returned to your area.
At that particular, I don't know the chronology, but I received a directive that we were to go down to a railroad station, make sure shower facilities were set up and that food was prepared, that there was a train of slave labor coming by. And these slave laborers I knew were not going to come in Pullman cars. They were going to be transferred back to where they would come. I might add, they were in slave labor in the manufacturing area of France. The train pulled in. There were, I'm estimating, maybe 30, 40 cars pulled by a locomotive that stopped, and they opened them up, and we saw women.
These were box cars?
Box cars. The chairman, the infantrymen knew these as 48s. That's the way during World War I. There's a French term for it, but you'll have to pardon my English, that I don't know the French term for it. And they opened these boxcars up, and these were women of all ages. Could not have been many older ones, and I don't want to dramatize this, because the old couldn't have survived. What was old? 50s? I would guess about 50s. And these were women in the 40s, 30s, even in teenage, who were under slave labor in France. Visualize their type, their life, the lives that they lead. They got off, they were showered, we fed them. And I might add, an aside, the human instinct of males in warfare, males, young, vibrant males filled with testosterone in warfare, not seeing females, to see females, to their credit, they lost any sexual urges when they saw a female in compassion for what these women gave through. I'll never forget that. To make this kind of a relationship, to make sure they were taken care of. These did not become women for sexual reasons. These were their daughter, their sisters, and their mothers. They made sure how they catered to them and put them back on the cars. You know, Dick, I didn't think of that whole story, the wholesome men of our men, to maybe when we first talked about it.
Very interesting.
And then the train took them wherever they were, I would hope, to their homes, if they could find them.
Now, you were in charge of athletics, you said, and you had to invent programs to keep the troops active, busy.
At that time, I was, 23, 24. Our regiment, 315th, had men soldiered there who were equivalent to any Major League Baseball player you have today. That's the kind of player, because they played for Bendix Bodies, General Motors, Ford, because these large corporations sponsored baseball, softball teams, and I had that. That's the kind of play. And I organized this. At the same time, regimental officers, athletic officers, also have to serve as umpires. But you did not umpire in your regiment. You were other regiments. So I remember umpiring a game of our regiment, 314th, and these were outstanding players. And I was in softball. You played softball, and you know you had 10 men, short center field, and I was stationed myself behind second base. Incidentally, you were trained to be an umpire, because the Army took care of that. And one of the ball players hit a line drive worthy, I don't want to use a Red Sox, I'll use a Yankee. Worthy of a Rodriguez. It was a scorcher out of the 70s. That center fielder made a catch horizontal to the ground. I've never seen anything like it until I saw Mike Krivich later on of the White Sox playing the Yankees take a hit away from Lou Gehrig. And he caught this ball off Brown. I was no longer an umpire. Dick, I became a fan. Can you imagine an umpire? Picture me, I was wearing my umpire, and I was so embarrassed because I applauded the catch. Was I supposed to do it? No, but damn right I did.
Good story. Now, when did you leave Europe for home?
Well, sadly, we knew there was a war on. The war was still raging in Japan. That was worried us. You know what was on my mind? There was beaches in Japan. There were beaches that we were going to have to enter. We never heard of the atom bomb. Didn't exist. All we knew that we were fodder for those beaches, and we were going to have to train. We were sent down to Normandy. We were sent down to Marseille. And we knew we were going to be trained, but I didn't answer your question. But we were shipped out. We were finally shipped out, and it's there that we learned that the war was over. That the war ended in August of 45, and there was a monstrous weapon used. We didn't know what the weapon was. That flashed the skies. We didn't know which cities or what the weapons was, or the cities that were hit were subsequently, what was it? Hiroshima.
Nagasaki.
But all I remembered when that happened was that the bomb exploded, we were told, and we jumped for joy. It's better their death than us. We had seen what damaged beaches can do to with the human body. Mm-hmm. We had seen corpses of warfare, and that was what we visualized. And if I wrestled with words in my lifetime, I wrestled with that even today, was jumping for joy when we subsequently learned two cities were destroyed.
Right. Now, you arrived in New York in December of 45?
Yes, yes.
And what's the first thing you did when you got off the ship?
Well, they told us there were going to be telephones made available when we got off. One thing you should know, remember the captain of the ship, I think it was the Erickson, pleading with us as the ship came into to the harbor. It was the Brooklyn Harbor we came in, saying, stay away from this side because you'll tip the ship over. Nobody listened. And we got, well, fast forward, we were off the ship, and I spoke to Roz, that's my fiance. And of course, I could hear the tears of joy in her, from her voice. And she didn't say hello to me. She just said, "Did you call your mother first?" And I said, "No." She said, "Don't you ever tell your mother that you called me first." How considerate and thoughtful she was.
Yes. Now, well, after you finally left the ship, where did you go?
Well, you must know this. Before I got off, I got off the telephone, stopped mm-hmm. talking to her. Now, this was December 10th, 11th, 8 days before my mother's birthday, I might say. She told me that you're going to be married soon. And I kiddingly said, "To whom?" She said, "Don't be so funny." January 1st, 1946, she, her mom, had made all the plans for her wedding. That let me off the hook, right?
Sure, sure. Now, well, you went back to Fort Dix?
Yes, Fort Dix.
And when did you leave active duty?
Well, I left after duty. I think I was finished February 20-something. Mm-hmm. Are there 28 months to February? It had to be 26.
Okay.
No, leap year of 1945. And at that time, it was a 46? I love trying. Yeah, 1946. And I must, you got to remember this, that I knew that they were talking to us, they were going to need reserve officers. At that time, I had just become a captain, and I signed up for the reserves. I mean, yeah.
But active duty now, you were
I was finished
active
duty.
And what did you do after you left the service?
Well,
did you go back to school?
I came home, settled in. I was a married man. And my mother and urged me, and Roz, of course, to go back to college, Brooklyn College. Mm-hmm. I always call it Poor Man's Harvard. I went back and got my degree, and I think it was an important, it set me up for what I was about to come.
Did you take advantage of the GI Bill?
Yes, the GI Bill. Went back to college. I got my Bachelor's of Art, worked for my father. And I was made for that kind of business. I wasn't made for that kind of business. My father gave me something to do. At that, 6 months after that, my father-in-law helped his two sons go into the carpeting business. That was the family business. And a unknown area, a farm country, which became the famous Long Island. And they opened a chain of stores, and I worked for them for about 9 years. We also helped invent a new term called the suburbs. Levittown, Long Island. Of course, we lived for a short time. Mother and father, we were of our firstborn child, our lovely daughter. Shall I tell you her age now?
In a few minutes.
We moved to Levittown, and I worked for my brothers-in-law for X amount of years.
And then you decided to make a complete turn in your career, correct?
You bet. With the urging of friends. I think it started when I was in my mother's womb, because she would probably look down and she said to me, this her fetus and embryo, "You are going to become a teacher." And I did. I went back to school. Couldn't do it without Roz. I went back to Hofstra. At that time it was Hofstra College. That time, we were also living in a city called, a suburb called East Meadow, and the college was the same distance from where the studio to half the distance to where Pittsfield is today, 3 miles.
Mm-hmm. And you got a master's degree, is that correct?
Got a master's degree in education. I knew this, GI Bill set in, and went back, I was the one of, among the oldest in the class at age, at that age, my, I was 39, 38. Was I that young once? Anyway, I went, we went back to college and got my degree.
And where did you start teaching, Bob?
Well, there's a little, you mind if I tell you this?
No.
I'd left my job. And the need for substitutes was there. And I was, how did I know about this? I had several friends. Blanche was one of them, our neighbor. Blanche Goodstein, I still remember her, God bless her soul. You substitute. And I had other friends tell me, substitute. Meantime, I was looking for a job and a substitute. One of the places that I had substituted in was Wyandanch, which 20 miles from where I lived. But we had an we had a two-lane highway, at that time called Southern State Parkway, the speed limit 35 miles an hour. Well, I substituted there. And I was being interviewed for jobs, and finally I went to Brentwood where I ended up. They hired me, and they also promised me that I'd be able, they would give me as many substitute jobs as they can. And on a regular basis, that brought income in. When I started to sub in Brentwood, one morning the telephone rang. They needed my service elsewhere. Roz answered the phone. Mr. Rosenblatt, no, he's not home. He's elsewhere. And well, we need him to sub today. And my wife said, well, I will sub. Now, she had no idea about the classroom, but they needed a warm body desperately. But what a warm body they got. Yeah. She went to sub. They liked what they observed, and she subbed there on a regular basis, unlicensed, never having been in the classroom. That's the kind of person she was. She was ready. That inspired her to go back to school. She went back, you guessed it, to Hofstra. She had had some credit from Brooklyn College. She dropped out of Brooklyn College. And she went there, got her degree. She graduated, I think she was fast math, 43, 44, from Hofstra College. Her graduation was almost the same week to my daughter's high school graduation. Well, how about that?
Great story, great story. Now, you made that your career. When did you retire, Bob, from teaching?
Well, you know, teaching is a class act. You know that. I had to get that line in. Teaching is a class act. I retired from teaching, had to be in 1972. My wife wanted to retire, and we already had bought our house, our old barn in Lenox. Mm-hmm. And Roz said it was
Lenox,
ready.
Massachusetts.
From, yes. She forced the issue. She wanted to retire. So I didn't feel like commuting from East Meadow to there, so I retired. I was 61.
And of course, Tanglewood, with your interest in symphony.
Yes, we were fortunate in that we already had the home. We retired to Lenox, and we pretty well knew that a retirement was going to be, what's that phrase? Let me think for a minute. I can't think of it. I tell it to all the people, but I blanked out. If I remember before this interview, I'll blurt it out.
Okay.
Gainful unemployment.
Gainful unemployment.
Gainful unemployment. Thanks for being patient with me.
Very good. Now, can you tell me about your family, Bob?
Yes. Our firstborn is Glenn. Glenn Fast. Glenn is a mother of three children. Her oldest is a father of two children, who makes my daughter a grandmother.
Wow.
And Roz and I are great grandparents twice over. 2.5-year-old Maya, and she was born in March, April, May, June. She'll be 3 months old soon, Ella. both Southerners. Their mother's as Southern as can be. Danny, God bless her, she's just a great person. And so one is named Maya Ray, and the other, get this, Ella Sue. Gee, I better not bring this up because my grandson will hate me for saying if I got a middle name. Forgive me.
I'm sure he will. And you also had a son?
Son Paul, yes, Paul. Paul is going to be 56. He's, how do I describe his job? Glenn is, I have to get this in, worked for a gynecologist in obstetrics office. She's the office manager. Mm-hmm. Loves the people she works with. And I know the people that she works with, she's born to with people. And I think we know where she gets it from. She loves to work with people. And my son does too. He works for, he represents a wholesale carpet corporation where not only does he sells, he also has classes for architects, teaching them about the products mm-hmm. that the architects will be using in their buildings. Yes.
Well, you're blessed.
So I have five grandchildren, three from my daughter, and two. My son has two sons, Eric, who's a chef, and then there's Michael.
Great. Now, you told me that off camera that you had occasion to go back to Normandy for a visit.
Yes.
Can you tell me that story?
Yes, I had blocked out the war until two incidences. One, Spielberg, Saving Private Ryan, where all the memories of war, I don't think I would have ever been able to do this interview until Private Ryan. And that seemed to break that wall down and reacting what you see at the beaches in warfare. My grandson, that's Sean, we call him Shlomo, who lived in South Carolina. He wasn't married at the time. Said, hey, Gramps, how about we go back to Normandy? And I was reluctant. Well, after urging by Sean and encouraged by Roz, we made the trip back to Normandy.
Just you and your grandson?
Just the two of us, two guys. And he made the arrangements going back to Caen, C-A-E-N, a city that was the British area of operations that was totally destroyed but that was before the breakout at St. Lo. And we stayed at a lovely place there. And we toured the beaches. Fortunately, we met up with a young historian, a Canadian. We met her at Caen. They have a service center. And they encourage all returning veterans to sign in and to talk to them. And they have a special center there. And she was visiting her friend who directed that center. And I remember bringing up, would you like to join us? She had no car. We had rented a car. Sean took care of that. And this is even before we knew she spoke fluent French. She joined us for the 2 days. And that was an experience having her with us.
Right.
Making the tour. And I remember my first day at the beach, Utah Beach, and we were standing there in the rain. And human beings, when they're idle, at least I do, have pop-up memories. They pop up like a little design of children books. You look at it with papa, it popped up and you have memories. And I don't mean to be dramatic, but how else to tell this story? Standing on that beaches, and my memory popped, and how quiet it was. And then I have this visualization. I was telling Sean about the bombardment of the beaches. Then we moved off to the beach, and being human beings, we were hungry, and we drove to a place. We were sitting off this beach, And we moved up to Utah, from Utah to Omaha. Omaha was the beach that took all the action. And you see Private Ryan, that was the beach, where the 29th Infantry Division, if you ever meet a person with that regiment, you should stand up and salute them. That, it was their beach. Picture the scene, we were having our lunch, it was a beautiful day, a beautiful June day, and I saw three people, and we were on the beach, playing some kind of game. Before that, there was one boat bobbing up, a fisherman boat in the water. Can you picture this? That one boat bobbing up, going back some 60 years later, and what took place on that beach, one boat, quiet, from this peaceful scene in that cloudy day, June 6th, what these clobbering those boats took. Hear how peace, how God created nature and man creating warfare. Then we walked down to loving, wanting to talk to this people, and I blurted out, do you know what went on here June 6th, adding these people? And the man said to me, he happened to be English, said to me in perfect English, he said, you bet I do. I was a young lad, and I remember you Yanks coming to visit us, and asking, do you have any gum chum brought back? I hadn't heard that phrase. Did you ever hear that?
No.
Do you have any gum chum? Asking the Yanks for that, and I remember how busy the roads were in preparation.
Right.
Then we moved on. I don't know if that was the same day. The French don't want to ever forget Normandy, and they brought classes on a field trip. These kids were on the beaches where so many had fallen and peaceful, having their field day there. One kid came up to greet us, and you know what he asked us? Not that you have any gum shum. Do you have a cigarette?
Really?
That's in English, he asked that.
Amazing. Now, Bob, you also mentioned that you had occasion to visit the American cemetery in Normandy.
We visited three cemeteries. Let me tell you about the awesome feel that you have, the quiet. And rows of stones, gleaming white, and how pristine, pure each grave was. I watched my grandson. I was sitting on a site, like outside a mausoleum. He didn't join me; just sat there alone. He has the advantage of 40 years, or X amount of years younger than I. And he was, and watching him stop. At each grave, it seemed that each gravestone, that beautiful day, looking at it. And he muttered, 21, 19, 23. He was reading off their ages. And when he came to a Star of David, which was a Jew, being Jewish, having pride in being a Jew, being Jewish, look, a Jewish soldier fell here and seeing one cross after another and remarking, we went to the British cemetery. Then we paid our respect to the German soldiers to see too. There they gave not only their age, but the regiments, the issue they fell with. And the French paid honor to the German dead by keeping their cemeteries clean. But it's an awesome sight.
That'll be very touching.
And being an American, guess what we did after that? We went shopping.
Bob, we're winding down now, but I do have one last question.
Yes.
Do you feel that your time in the service and your experiences had a negative or a positive effect on the rest of your life?
I look at that. I might say this was a war that took my youth. But that's not a negative. If you look at a coin, there are two sides of a coin. That's life. Yes. But coming out of an era of the Depression, coming out of an era where you practically, you live day to day, you have the strength of family, and the Army became my family. I was going to graduate from college, but where was I going? 25% unemployment? What was the chance for a 22-year-old, 23? Did I realize that at the time? Probably not. But I wasn't prepared to go out in civilian life. I found a home after the fact. It was dangerous, of course it was. It gave me an insight. It made me, there were various ages of life, as a teenager, as a 21-year-old, as a father, a parent, a husband, as an old man in his 80s. So you have various phases. It gave me strength. It helped me strength. Did it give me compassion? Yes. This was, if there's any war, there's a good war. Was this the good war? That's the question I leave. Was this the good war? Is my generation the greatest generation? I just don't know. I wrestle with these words. Was this experience a bad experience? Oh no. It made me appreciate the United States. Am I a flag waver? I thought I wasn't. But I remember having tears in my eyes at a retreat ceremony with the bands playing, even today. Mm-hmm. So repeat your question again so I know I'm on track.
Well, I asked you, did you feel that all your experiences in the military had a positive or a negative effect?
So. To answer your one word, it had a positive effect.
Very good. Bob, I want to thank you for coming here today and doing this interview.
I'm honored. Thank you very much.
More importantly, I want to thank you for your sacrifices and your courage and for your service to your country.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you. All right.